Yeah, hello all. Welcome to my video. In this particular, YouTube video, I'm actually going to share my real-time experience as an interview panel member for actually multiple jobs or roles in Agile. What are all the typical a kind of a situational questions or a kind of a scenario driven questions which I typically ask. Okay, so because I'm actually making this video when I'm actually traveling from one place to some other place, I have actually deliberately kept my video off, nothing apart from that. So let us actually get into the LinkedIn article what I have written pertaining to this particular thing. Okay, now if you go to this particular LinkedIn article which I have written few days back, I have basically given some five sample questions, right? And typically you cannot answer these five questions if you are not experienced in Agile. So in this particular video, I'm actually was actually thinking to add value to people who are preparing for interviews by actually giving my real-time perspectives as an interview panel member for actually multiple jobs or roles in Agile for the past many years, right? Okay, so let us take the first question as a sample. So whenever I am actually taking an interview, right? One of the common question which I typically ask is, I will try to pull out a real-time burn-down chart, a real-time cumulative flow diagram, a real-time program predictability measure report from the safe, and then ask the candidate, okay, what could be the potential bottlenecks, or rather, what could be the recommendation or a remediation as a coach from your end. So, what I suggest you people like, whosoever actually listening to this particular YouTube video of mine, pause the video, go ahead and then drag a paper pen or a kind of a digital notepad, and then no, pause the video and then start taking notes then and there, which actually could serve as a future reference for you. Okay, now to share my perspective to this particular question is a burn down chart, right? A burn down chart typically can be used for a progress tracking and also to know the remaining work, right? Because a burn down chart visually represents the progress of the team throughout that particular iteration. And if that particular chart is trending downwards, then it means that it actually indicates that the team is completing the task according to the plan. Now, in terms of the remaining work, right, basically we may need to take a look into the slope of the burn down line. For example, if the slope of the burn down line shows the rate at which the work is getting completed, right? So depending upon whether it's a flat slope, because if it is a flat slope, it actually indicates a slower progress. So depending upon the slope, right, you can tell whether the teams are making a rapid progress or a slower progress. Okay, so see, in this video I can only give you people high level thoughts, right? You still need to do the homework of taking your real-time burn down chart and then try to make some kind of a interpretation, some kind of a analysis and all. Also, one more point which need to be kept in the mind is, are there any variances? Are there any kind of a scope creep? Are there any kind of an additional work which got added post the beginning of the current sprint? Also, we may need to look into the dependency delays, all those things. So instead of asking people, right, okay, what does a burn down chart look like, or how does a cumulative flow diagram look like, the best way to take an interview is pull out a real-time burn down chart, pull out a real-time cumulative flow diagram, pull out a real-time program predictability measure report, share this screen, and then I will ask the candidate, if the slope of this curve looks like this, then what do you mean by it? Okay, what is your interpretation? Where is the bottleneck? What is your recommendation and remediation as a coach? Believe me, many candidates are actually unable to answer this particular question despite they claim to have a lot of Agile certifications, and also despite they claim to have lot of experience in Agile. Okay, say for example, right, if you are actually looking into the cumulative flow diagram, analyzing the horizontal distance between the lines can actually reveal certain insights from us, right? So if you actually look into my own LinkedIn post, right, few years back, I have already written a LinkedIn article, how to analyze a cumulative flow diagram, what it means, because in a cumulative flow diagram, the distance between the two lines should be an optimum one. Neither it should be too close to each other, nor it should be separated away, right? And also, wherever you see in the cumulative flow diagram, whenever a line is parallel to the horizontal x-axis, fundamentally it means that throughput is zero over there. It actually means no work got completed within that particular time span. So what is needed is you people need to have the real-time capability to really do analysis of a burn-down chart, really do analysis of a cumulative flow diagram, and then come up with the recommendations or remediations, right? Okay, now, going back to the program predictability measure report, right, which we call as a PPM report. So PPM report is actually going to tell at a program level, typically at an agile release train level, what is the commitment reliability, or rather what is the program level predictability, as the name indicates. So what I suggest to people is that why don't you take some real-time program predictability measure report from your own project, or you actually talk to people who is working on SAFe, and then try to visualize the program predictability measure report, and then try to pull out inferences from it. Okay, that will actually put your capability all together to a different platform, rather than keep on reading pages and pages on all these charts or reports theoretically. Okay, now let us go to the next question in the interest of time. The second question is, how will you implement the lean budget guardrails practically using a tool, say, target process? See, now you may need to understand certain concepts here. We have multiple value stream management platform tools. We have multiple tools in the market, which typically supports a kind of a dynamic budgeting, or a kind of a portfolio level plug and play, right? See, for example, if you are taking Jira, then probably Jira Align gives lot of capabilities at a portfolio level. Similarly, you have a tool called the Target Process. You have a tool called the Micro Focus. You have a tool called the Jellyfish. And you also have a tool called the Tasktop Integration Hub, Tasktop Integration Viz. Okay, so let me just repeat the name of the tools for the larger audience. Target Process, Micro Focus, Jellyfish, Jira Align, Tasktop Integration Hub, Tasktop Integration Viz. So these are all some of the tools which will give you the real-time capability to do some value stream management platform, kind of a dynamic budgeting across the value stream. That is why these tools are picking up momentum in the market whenever the companies are trying to move from a project to product mindset. Okay, now in the interview, whenever I am actually conducting interviews for enterprise agile coaches, I actually ask the question, right? Okay, how do you practically set it up, right? So for example, right, you may need to identify the budget level, then probably you may need to identify the budget parameters, and you may need to use the target process to configure entities which typically align with your project hierarchy. And this may include creating portfolios, programs, your teams, projects, and work items. Then what you need to do, you may need to create a custom field for the budget. And the most important thing is you also need to integrate it with the financial system. And then only you can proceed to allocate the budget. Then you need to create the dashboard. You need to feed it with a real-time update. Also, you may need to take a role-based access control, followed by your training and communication feedback mechanism and the budget review meetings. So these are all the entire process involved. So whenever I am taking interview, I will not be asking, you know, asking the candidate, okay, can you explain lean budget guardrails, which is used in the SAFe framework? Because any guy who has watched a YouTube video on it can actually give a theoretical answer. I will give them a situation. If I give you a tool like a target process, now you tell me exactly where will you go and then how will you set it up? Where will you change the configuration setting? Where will you go and enable what? What is the prerequisite? What are the precursor activities? Okay. Now, let us go to the next one. Okay. In the next question, right? This is like a situation question, right? So a prospect or a lead approaches you as an Agile consultant so as to do an Agile transformation service. So the prospect is actually insisting on an outcome-driven pricing model, which is a subcategory of a non-linear pricing model. However, you as an Agile expert know that the prospect's Agile maturity level is in the beginner level. So you are not convinced to go for a non-linear model. Now, in this case, how will you approach the situation? So what I suggest to the audience is, why don't you pause the video now? Instead of listening to the video continuously, why don't you pause the video? You can take a paper pen, do some kind of a thinking, come up with some solution, and then try to continue my video, and then try to compare your answer with my answer, try to do a gap analysis. That will actually indeed increase your horizons of a thinking, right? So probably you can actually pause the video here and then do that thinking process. All right, so hopefully you have done the thinking process. Now my approach to this situation is that, right, see, we have actually multiple Agile pricing models. We have so many models within the linear model, and also we have so many contracting models or a pricing model within non-linear model. But what is important is responding to an RFP is an art rather than a science. Of course, yes, we have some techniques, we have some pricing models, we have some contracting models, fully agreed. But then which model to use where and to what extent and for what reason? That particular thing comes out of experiential intuition. It actually doesn't come out of a so-called logical thinking. So from my perspective, if such a situation happens, one may need to understand the prospect's need first of all. Then probably get into a thorough conversation with the prospect to understand the specific goals, challenges, expectations from the Agile transformation, means the envisaged Agile transformation, identify the key outcomes that they are looking for, and then try to align these with their current Agile maturity level. Now, also sometimes we may need to educate the prospect on the Agile maturity level, right? So you may need to share some kind of an insights, share some kind of a best practices regarding different maturity levels, and then emphasize the importance of aligning the pricing model together with the organization's current state of maturity, and also provide examples in terms of how organizations typically progress through the different stages of Agile maturity and what could be the corresponding impact on the outcomes. Then probably you may need to start by doing some kind of a piloting, highlight the value of iterative approaches, propose a hybrid model, share some kind of a case studies and success stories of actually creating your own Agile maturity trajectory for some other clients, and then you may need to build the trust and the relationship, and then probably seek a pilot project. See, it is more of a by actually taking a consultative and a collaborative approach, you can work towards finding a pricing model that aligns with the prospect's need while still ensuring a realistic and a effective Agile transformation given in their current maturity level. So how you do exactly that actually depends upon so many factors. Okay, in this particular YouTube video, I can only share you high level thought process, because this is not a one-on-one mentoring session, or this is not a webinar where I can pick up certain thing and then deep dive it. I am just sharing the parent notes of the tree. You may still need to do your homework to find the child notes. Okay, of course, as part of my Agile mentorship program, which is actually popularly called as a AMP, all these real-time capabilities will be teach to you by me. But like a YouTube video like this on a social media platform, I can only give high-level summary. Okay, all right. Now, in the interest of time, let me just go to the next one. Okay, so the next thing is something like this, right? A project was actually started. We actually begin a project. Then after a couple of iterations, something changed. And now the concern is that how we can actually entertain the modified boundary of the work for a different, you know, within the same pricing. Okay, so because the screen is shared, you can actually go through it in a verbatim manner. But then, no, just to cut a long story short, initially they have thought this project is only an upgrade project. Later they came to know it is a combination of an upgrade and a modernization project. Now the challenge is, how are we going to handle the situation so as to entertain modernization also within the same agreed upon cost factor, and how will you create a go green plan and then implement it? See, believe me one thing, one of the very, very important skills or capabilities that you need to have currently in today's IT market is the ability to create a go green plan and also to implement the go green plan and to convert a project from red to amber, then from amber to green. Whether you use Scrum or Kanban or Less or Dad or Spotify or Nexus or Safe, who actually cares about it? Everyone cares about the outcome. Everyone cares about the results. No one is interested in the framework or project or product. But then everyone is interested to have their problems solved. So in my experience, right, you may need to probably start with an assessment, understand the scope of the work, do a risk analysis, review the existing SOW. Then you need to have a client communication followed by a negotiation strategy. Then you may need to take a trade-off call, right? You may need to call out the present options, and then you may need to highlight the trade-off. Then you may need to go for a suitable agile adaptation method. Also, you may need to focus on a cost-effective resource utilization in terms of your capability optimization of the team, followed by automation and tools. And also, you may need to keep an eye on the continuous monitoring and the adjustment based on the Agile metrics review, based on the retrospective action items. Then you may need to also call out a continuous improvement and a sustainability plan, followed by a risk mitigation plan, right? So I was just giving you high level pointers how you can approach this particular situation. If in case you wanted to connect with me to have a one-on-one conversation, probably I will be dropping my WhatsApp number in the comment section or in the description of this particular video. When I'm going to upload it, you can actually ping me on a WhatsApp. All right, now let us go to the next question. Describe your approach to building your own customized scaling framework in an enterprise environment. Of course, you cannot take directly Safe or Less huge, but then you can take the principles behind the practices and then try to come up with a customized scalable agile framework at an enterprise level, right? This is the question. So what I request is, again, you people can take a pause, find out your own thoughts, and then continue with my video in terms of how am I actually solutioning it. Now, in terms of the solutioning, right? First of all, I may need to call out an approach, right? So I may need to do an assessment and analysis to understand the organization's unique need, culture, existing process, analyze the current state of agile practices across the team. Then I need to think about a cross-functional collaboration. I need to know the organization values and objectives. What is the OKR, KRA, like objective and key results? then KRA, key result areas, then KPIs, key performance indicators. Then I may need to look into the key considerations in terms of the scalability, the cultural fit, in terms of the customizations, and what could be the anticipated challenges. Some of the challenges could be resistance to the change. Some of the challenges could be integration with the existing processes, then maintaining a consistency across the team. Then what could be the best strategies and the best practices to plug the gap? Need to have a clear communication, need to focus on the pilot programs, need to focus on the metrics and the monitoring, need to have a scalable community of practices, and definitely we need to have a leadership support followed by a governance structure, standardization of some of the key elements. Also need to have clarity on when to go for a centralized decision making versus a decentralized one. When to go for a centralized guidance versus a decentralized execution, followed by the technology support, followed by the regular inspect and adapt. So what is more important is in these kind of a situation is actually not just knowing about safe or less huge. What are the principles behind the practices? If you know the principles, believe me, you can create your own customized framework and then try to, pilot it across a few initiatives, then probably take it to the next level, right? So this particular video is an attempt from my end to just, give a high level view in terms of how does a real-time scenario-driven questions look like. Now, if you wanted to be mentored by me, then there is a separate lesson plan in my Agile mentorship program, AMP, which is called as a 150 Agile interview question and answers. So if you are interested to enroll for that particular lesson plan, or if you wanted any kind of a career coaching, any kind of a coaching for to help you to clear the interview, or if you wanted to connect with me to discuss with me how to overcome your challenges, please feel free to ping me on WhatsApp. We will see, we can see what is the best we can do it for you. Okay, fine then, and hope to see you in some other video soon. Okay, cheers, bye.